and respected football managers of the post-war era. The man who created in the Leeds United of the 60s and 70s one of the finest soccer sides in Europe. Mr. Reevey had been suffering from the incurable motor neurone disease for 2 years. He died on Friday. The mourners at today's funeral service included some of the best-known people in the game. From Scotland now, Chris Kiddy reports.
The service was held at Warriston Crematorium in Edinburgh, about 25 miles from Don Revy's adopted Scottish home in Kinross. Among the mourners, some of the most well-known names and faces in football from the 60s and 70s. Members of the Leeds United team, which Revy forged into one of the best sides in Europe. Players who'd followed Revy into the manager's chair at Elland Road, but never quite recreated the glory years. Tributes from friends and colleagues flowed freely.
Don Revy built a great team, and he had a special relationship with all the players, I think, and they were a special group, and certainly look back on it fondly.
He was a very warm, friendly man who had a great family himself and encouraged the family atmosphere in a football club, which is very difficult. And he produced some tremendous players who carried on, a lot of them in football, to do good things, and that came out of the family type of club that he had.
I think for 2 or 3 years at Leeds United, he probably produced sides as good as anywhere in the world up to that point. I've got great affection for him, and I'm just so sad that the end was such a painful one for him and came so devastatingly early. I've got great memories of Don Revy, and he'll go down, I think, as one of our great football managers.
Former England skipper under Revy, Kevin Keegan, flew in specially from Spain.
You know, I walked out on him as an England player, and he phoned me up and told me to come back. He's like a father to me, you know, and he saved my England career. He was a great manager. I just think he was very unfortunate that we just didn't have any good players. As simple as that. If the players had been good enough, he would have probably been as great a success as Alf Ramsey.
When the cortege arrived, Revy's widow, Elsie, had to be helped into the chapel. Revy's motto had been keep fighting. He fought to the end against the incurable muscle-wasting motor neurone disease. He was just 61. As a small group of fans who'd travelled up from Leeds waited outside, the Reverend Leslie Barr paid his own tribute.
His strength of resolve and the desire to win were matched by what one of his players described in recent days as a fatherly care for those who knew him best. While the soccer world has lost a well-known personality, in a strange way, he is still a hero figure to some young people today.
Chris Kiddy reporting on the funeral today of Don Revy in Scotland. Well, on the day that Don Revy announced that he was suffering from motor neurone disease, he gave a lengthy interview to our reporter, John Helm, in which he looked back over his glittering career in football. We're now broadcasting the highlights of that interview for the first time.
You know, they talk about good managers and talk about good coaches. I think if you've got good players in your club, then good players make good managers and bad players make bad managers. Because I always used to say, Bill Shank and I, that if we were at Halifax Town and they left us with the same type of players and no money, we'd have possibly got them organised well and got them super fit. But we'd never won anything, because you can't make bad players into good players and you can't make good players into great players. And all these lads that we had at Leeds, about 18, 16 internationals, all had tremendous flair and tremendous talent. And I think they only come together once in a lifetime.
Was one important attribute the fact that everybody in the team scored goals? I mean, it wasn't just left to Mick Jones and Alan Clark, everybody got them, didn't they?
That's right, Alan Clark got plenty of goals because that was his great asset, and Mick Jones was a tremendous player for our team. But Peter Lorimer got them, Eddie Gray got them, Billy got them, John got them, even fullbacks got them, Paulini, Terry Cooper, because they'd come on the overlaps. But they could all control the ball, John, one touch, and they could all play and had a great vision of the game and great quick brains on them. And all I wanted to do at that time was learn every day. In every training session, every match, I wanted to learn something new. And we kept adding it to the team. But there were type of players you could just talk to, and they knew what to do.
Other clubs were terrified of coming to Elland Road then, weren't they?
I don't think they liked it. There was a story, you know, that Mike Doyle, when I took over the England job, and he was in my squad, he told me a story the first week that he joined when I had the England team. He said, we'd be in the bath at Main Road in Manchester City, and they had a good side at the time, Lee and someone being all that crowd. He said, we'd all be singing, we'd won at home 3 or 4 nothing, and someone said, oh, do we play next week? Lee's at Ellen Road. They said the bath used to go deathly silent, didn't like going to Ellen Road. Nobody, no, you're right.
1968 was a milestone in the lives of Don Revie and Leeds United. Terry Cooper's Wembley goal against Arsenal won the club its first major trophy. The league title followed the next season, but not all dreams were fulfilled.
I just wanted to live for the day when we'd be champions of the First Division. And then I lived for the day and never got it, to be European champions and then go on and possibly lift the World Club Championship. We got the semi-final once when I was there against Celtic and lost in the European Cup semi-final. But that's another dream I had, to win the European Cup. But 1968 was the year that year I'd go to Liverpool to get the point to win the championship. That was fantastic.
What are your memories of that night?
Well, the memories will live with me forever, that memory, because Billy Bremner took our team when we won the championship to the Leeds support. There was about 10,000 of them on the left-hand side of the ground, behind the goal. Then he brought them back to me. And I said, Bill, take them to the cop. Oh, I don't fancy that, boss. I said, go on, take them. So he walked the team, and I can see them walking now towards the cop, and the cop, 27,000, went deathly silent, and they let him get within 6 yards with the team of the cop. Then they all started, champions, and they wouldn't let the players off the pitch for 7 minutes. And they'd just lost the championship that night, and they roared and roared, and oh, it was a tremendous reception we got.
To say you were deadly rivals, you had a very strange rapport with Liverpool, and of course you did as well with Bill Shankly.
Yeah, Bill Shankly and I were very close. He used to phone me every Saturday night before match of the day. And he came in the dressing room after that game with all the Liverpool players still in the strip with a bottle of champagne each for our lads. And he'd give them all the champagne. He said, Don, can I just have a minute? So I said to the lads, let's be quiet, Mr. Shankly wants to say something. And he said, all I've got to say to you boys, you're a great side and you deserve to win it. You didn't pinch it, you didn't fluke it, you're a wonderful team. Now, coming from Shanks, that was praise indeed.
Did it rankle with you that many people said that but for some certain superstitions, you might have won more?
Well, there's a story about that, John. Gypsies used to live on Ellen Road before it was a football ground. And we missed 3 or 4 years of totally missing trophies. And I got this letter one day saying that there's a curse put on the ground by the Gypsies when they were moved off for it to be a football ground. And the only way I could get the curse moved was getting a practicing Gypsy to come to the ground. So anyway, cut a long story short, I sent over to Blackpool a car to bring Gypsy Rose Lee, was her name. She's in Scarborough now, actually, to the ground. She shifted everybody out the ground except me, the office staff, the groundsmen, the cleaning women. And she went out on the ground, stood in the middle of the pitch, scratched the grass, threw some seeds down, went in each corner flag and did the same. Came off the pitch, came in my office with a cup of tea, and she said, now you'll start winning things. And we did from that year on.
Possibly we'll find her again.
So that's superstition.
John Helm with Don Revie, the man who made the names of Leeds and Yorkshire famous wherever in the world a football was kicked. And that, of course.
So, with these pictures of their greatness, and of course, goes without saying, his greatness, we will say good night to you.
Lorimer with the kick. Curling in. Madeley, Jack Charlton, in the net!
It was a farewell to a man who led United during the so-called glory years when the team won all the major trophies. Revie was 61 when he died on Friday, a victim of the disabling motor neurone disease. But he faced up to the disease with the same courage he'd shown throughout his footballing career. From Edinburgh, here's Harry.
The Leeds United team called Don Revy simply the boss, and they were there in force to say their last farewells to the club's greatest manager. Even those who'd left the game couldn't forget Don Revy.
It was like, it was a family. All the lads, he felt involved and nobody was left out of it at all, you know. He'll be sadly missed for many, many years at Leeds. A lot of people will remember him, you know. The lads thought a lot of him. He was one of the top four managers there's ever been, I would think.
What was he like as a man, Alan?
Gentle. In every sense of the word. A lot of respect for people. Very loyal and honest man. Great fella.
When Revy became England manager, he restored Kevin Keegan's flagging career.
I think he had so much to offer. And I think he's been very much misunderstood by a lot of people. And there'll be a lot of people who wrote things about him who will maybe think twice and really ask themselves if they were fair to the man, because he should have been thought of in much better light in the game of football. In Leeds, they should build a shrine to him. They really should.
Scots Gordon McQueen and Joe Jordan were key members of that Revy team.
I think to most people here, I think he gave the principles which, as I say, were given to me when I first came down to England. I was about 18 and a half. The dedication and the discipline. And those things are something that, from when I learned, I've had all through my career.
The floral tributes came from all over the country, but a group of Leeds fans summed up what Revy meant to the club.
Speaking for me and for the rest of the lads, I think he gave most of us probably a very happy childhood. With the team he built, well, we all know what it was. Probably best in Europe, and we're very unlikely to see a team like that again.
It's obviously deeply affected you, this, hasn't it?
Oh, it's like losing part of your family.
The Leeds United family, as it was known, like Billy Bremner, had obviously special association with him. But so too did Laurie McMenemy, the former Southampton and Sunderland manager.
As far as football is concerned, he helped me tremendously and a lot of other young managers starting off. He always made you feel as if you were First Division, even though you were managing in the fourth at the time. And he was always first on the telephone with any advice, especially if you weren't doing too well.
There's no doubt that the boss would have been happy with the send-off he received from the team that won every honour for Leeds United. I can well remember the first time I met Don Revy. I was a rather nervous cub reporter with Radio Leeds, and to be honest, the first interview I did with him wasn't very good. At the end of it, he said, "I'll tell you what, lad, let's do it again." I soon learned that Don Revy was more than a manager. He was a person who cared very deeply for his players. Today, of course, they've respected him by all reassembling together. All the great team players are there. But I reckon he would have had extra pleasure in two of those members today, Alan Clark and Mick Jones, because the greatest memory of Leeds United for me was back in the FA Centenary Final in 1972. You remember it, don't you? Jones down the right, the cross comes over, Alan Clark's there. Leeds beat Arsenal 1-0. A fitting tribute to one of the greatest managers this country has ever had.